All right, so I didn't think this was going to be like the theme of the channel, but apparently this is going to be all about interviews with socialists. That's what this channel is going to be about. So last time we were talking about Ben Burgess, right? The professor Ben Burgess. Today I wanted to talk about Elizabeth Bruenig, which I think is how you say her name. Bruenig, B-R-U-E-N-I-G. So she did an awesome debate with Brian Caplan. And I thought I could just give my thoughts on sort of her her viral video, or the video that apparently is going viral according to Dave Smith, although it's hard to imagine this video is really going viral. Maybe it was like on Twitter or something. I'm not really on Twitter, but she's like pretty smart, and it's pretty interesting to hear her talk. She's right about a few things that she talks about in that interview that's going around with, I think it's like at some libertarian convention or something. And I wanted to highlight those before I sort of pointed out why I thought the interview was funny and why I thought it was worth responding to. So like, I thought I was going to do this driving, but I don't think I need this driving because I got notes here. So she's right about four things, right? She's right about consent not being the same as legitimacy. So like when people talk about consent of the governed, she makes a good point in the interview where she says, I think it's actually like the classic democracy thing that she talks about, where she points out that, like, you know, if you have 51%, that doesn't give them a right to violate the rights of the 49%, which of course I think everyone agrees with, or most people do. The other thing that she talks about is magical thinking being nonsense. I'm going to talk about that a lot in a minute. She talks about force being inevitable as long as there's property. I think that's also true. Although she makes the same mistake Ben Burgess does in not being able to distinguish aggression from defense, but I'll talk about that in a second. And then the fourth thing that she's right about is what the law says isn't the same as what is morally true, right? Because she talks about ownership deeds or property claims with the person doing the interview there, and at some point he confuses the moral legitimacy of a property claim versus what the law says. So that's a good distinction to make. I would agree with all four of those things. But then she makes some really interesting mistakes, which I've never seen this done before. So I thought it was worth pointing out. So she talks about first appropriation, or she talks about like how property comes into being, right? How is it that you can take something out of a state of nature and make it into something that belongs to you and that you can have exclusion or exclusionary rights over? And so I thought it was funny. She brings up Adam Smith, which people like to bring up Adam Smith a lot, especially debating libertarians, even though Adam Smith isn't really someone who, I mean, he's someone known for his property theory, but he isn't really someone known for his libertarian philosophy, really. Not in the sense of having a consistent, a sort of consistent principle like the kind that a modern libertarian would identify with. Now, if socialists were to bring up Murray Rothbard and start quoting him and sort of present his position as the same as the modern libertarian position, that would be interesting. But instead they default to Adam Smith, who was sort of like Ayn Rand in the philosophical neighborhood of what a right-wing anarchist would identify with, but not exactly, not really. So she talks about first appropriation being sort of this metaphysical process by which you mix your labor with a resource in a state of nature, and that by doing that you sort of instill it with this quality that makes it your property. Of course, this is a misunderstanding, and she would have to admit that this characterization isn't really how it works, because the whole thing about socialism is that you're concerned with the worker. And what is the worker? A worker is someone who's doing something like appropriating a resource in your name. If you think about a mine worker, they're digging through dirt and they're cracking rock and collecting ore. So by that principle, the one that she's talking about, you would think that they would have instilled their property, they would have made it theirs, they would have instilled this magical property that that she's disagreeing with. Of course, that would be magical thinking, that is magical thinking, but that's not what a property claim really is. A property claim is simply a description of the state of circumstances where one person has a better claim over a piece of property than other people do. And what makes for a stronger claim than another? Well, we have to have some principle to judge that by, and the principle we judge that by is is how they came by it. Did they trade for it, or did they steal it? Did they take it from a state of nature, or did they take it from another person? That's basically what the concept comes down to. And so it's not a metaphysical thing, right? You really have to watch Brian Caplan's debate with Elizabeth, because it's really interesting. Elizabeth likes to come back to this point, and she makes it her final question for him, if I'm not mistaken. And she asks, how does property come into your possession? How does something become your property? And he uses the example of a desert island where, you know, you wash up ashore there and you build a hut. If the next person who washes up there claims that the hut is equally theirs, it's just plainly obvious by the circumstances that the person who invested their time and effort in creating that hut has a better claim on it. You could think of it as simply as, if the person hadn't gone through the trouble of making that investment, of doing that work, it wouldn't exist. And that goes the same with an enterprise like a mining company. If it wasn't for the company setting up that stuff, the mine wouldn't exist. And so it's, well, that's going off a tangent on the employer relationship. But the point is, it's not a metaphysical thing. It's not magical thinking. If you do want an example of magical thinking, the best place to look for it would be labor theory of value. Labor theory of value is probably the most prevalent form of thinking in economic thought, where the idea is that something has more value because of how much labor was invested in it. Now, that actually is an example of people thinking that physical actions are instilling inanimate objects with some sort of essence that binds it with sort of an enchanted a value. So it's an understanding of value as something other than subjective, which really is the most magical kind of thinking you'll come by in political thought, at least in my opinion. So the claim of the homesteader is a moral one, and it may be recognized by a judicial system, but it doesn't matter if it is. It still stands to reason that taxation is theft. Obviously, all questions of politics come down to who gets what, right? That's the basic concept of politics when you go into your first day of political science in high school or university or whatever. The first thing they tell you is, what does politics mean? Well, politics means who gets what. And the answer to that from the anarchist perspective is there isn't a collective answer to that. It's a matter of what happens to be true. And what happens to be true is that you either got it by stealing it, or you got it by trading for it, or you got it by taking it out of a state of nature where you weren't taking it from anyone else. So that's all it really comes down to. Even if you're ignoring the economic incentives of destroying the main reason people would go out of their way to create things, to do difficult work, in that they would be taking ownership of the product of that work, there's still always the main fallacy of being unable to distinguish aggression from defense. And defensive violence and aggressive violence are only comparable really on a superficial level. This is why, if there is a conflict, we concern ourselves with the nature of that conflict, not just that there were punches thrown, right? It doesn't matter that there are punches thrown. It matters why and who and when. And so the point that violence is going to come about as long as they're property, well, that's a truism, but violence is going to come about even if you try to eliminate the concept of property, if for no other reason than there's no difference between public ownership and state ownership. There's no such thing as common ownership, right? And this goes back to something I'm gonna have to make a video on. I keep thinking about it, but it hasn't come up yet. Well, it's come up a lot, but it just hasn't it hasn't come up in the stack yet. But you can't try to eliminate property as a way of trying to eliminate the use of force. It's just obviously not going to happen. You can't find any examples of common ownership. So if you were to try and say, well, I think Elizabeth's example was, you have someone who homesteads a plot of land and someone else trespasses into that land. When you take action to prevent their trespass or to evict them or to move them, then you are the one aggressing on them. So again, that's a confusion of what aggression and what defense is and what we're actually trying to avoid. I agree that violence or the use of force is unavoidable, so by that very premise, it's important to make distinctions as to what is moral and what is immoral, what is aggression, what is non-aggression, what is defense, and what is excessive. So I think her arguments are interesting in that she's somehow able to make these distinctions that are important in capitalist philosophy, but she's applying it to socialist philosophy, and it makes you wonder if one day maybe Elizabeth will be a capitalist, because if she really does have problems with ideas of like these metaphysical, magical forces, then well, I think she might be on the wrong side, but who knows. Anyways, hopefully next video is not about a socialist. It's just so entertaining and so interesting to dissect them and to just see the obvious fallacies, the kind of things you just, you know, you have a hard time imagining you saying them, right? It's just, it's funny. Anyway, see you guys next time.
So you're assuming, like, so on that, you know, here's what I would say. So I say there's a, you know, general moral principle that there's a presumption in favor of leaving people and their stuff alone. And if you need to save the universe, that's strong enough to overcome the presumption. All right, now as to how something becomes your own, just say that we all, they're like, you know, it is not hard for us to tell this under normal circumstances. If one person shows up on an island and builds a hut, and then another person washes up and say, that's my hut too, no one has any big trouble going and saying, no, it's not. That's the person might want to be nice and let you stay in their hut, but it's not theirs. You know, what I would say is we start off with the paradigmatic case of your own body, right? And say, like, well, how is it that your body comes to be yours? And, well, seems like you shouldn't go around touching other people's bodies without their consent. And then if a person's using their body to go and build something or make something that's been unowned, that doesn't seem like a problem. And then if, again, if you can go back and track it down further, say, well, so how do you get these items? Well, from another person. Where do they get them? Well, they're from another person. How do they get them? The right way. So again, I would just say that this is, you know, the usual case where, like, they're, like, you know, to come up with a general algorithm is neither possible nor necessary, because moral intuition is more than enough, right? And by the way, so if you are curious, so there is only one libertarian philosophy book that I swear by, and that is Mike Humer's The Problem of Political Authority. I'll take that one over all the others together. So it'll be my Bible, as it were.
But if I went round saying I was an emperor just because some moistened bint had lobbed a scimitar at me, they put me away!
Shut up! Will you shut up?
Ah, now we see the violence inherent in the system!